Welcome, 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 guys, to another stream. Today we are going to be playing Nightfall. Let me just clarify that straight away. I know we're in the Fire Island chain on my Mesmer. We are going to be playing Nightfall. We're going to continue. We've got the Martial Whispers. We've got all that good stuff. We're going along with it. However, I did want to just show off some stuff again. But it's okay, because on the streams, I'm pretty sure nobody's seen anything to do with this so far, which is excellent. So I wanted to show you guys this build, okay? I've done a video on it. I've done several videos on the main channel as well now. Not really talking about it or anything. Oh, well, we can sort out the Ultra Spud now. I'm actually a little bit scared because my PC's crashed 3 times today because of an out-of-memory error. And it crashed last week on Visual Wood as well, which is a bit scary on a new game that we're playing. But I did want to talk about some stuff. I hope you guys are all doing good. Today's been a very busy day for me. That's why we're starting 1 hour later than we usually would have. We'll probably end at the same-ish time. Maybe we'll go to like an hour and a half or something. But again, very busy day. I did want to get this stream done though. Oh, that's right. We need to change to Guild Wars 1, not Guild Wars 2. There we go. And so yeah, we're on the Fire Island chain right now. That's really not the focus. I wanted to talk about this team build. I wanted to talk about a little change that I've made that makes it even more ridiculous. So this is the Mesmer Way build that I've been playing oh so much of recently. That annihilates enemies because it has a really high quality of life spam on this skill here, Energy Surge. And then it combines the secondary Paragon for all kinds of other quality of life, juicy, lovely goodness abilities. See, Stan, never give up. There's another one that I wanted to use as well. Where is it? Never surrender. Yeah. For 15 seconds and it recalls down in 15 seconds, but does everyone get it? I don't know. So I wanted to talk about this a little bit more because I actually changed the healer. Now, before, Livia was set to run away and she was just like, it was like an old build. I hadn't even really assessed what she was doing properly. But I went to PVX Wiki, the Guild Wars 1 PVX Wiki. And looked up like the dedicated necro writ healer that you're supposed to be able to have, what people are suggesting. And actually, they're suggesting you can even go like some damage on there. So of course I wanted to take the option. Of course I did. So Livia is actually now massively boosting up the damage of our team. Before she was doing zero, okay? And what we were doing was we had her on to avoid combat, so she would do nothing. Now, though, she's actually going to contribute. She's on guard, which means she'll attack who I want her to attack. She's not quite as aggressive as the rest. We could put her aggressive. Let's put her aggressive for a second. This is crazy, okay? But the way that this is going to work, okay, is all of her skill, her hero AI routines are going to be running. It's going to be like, okay, do I want to cast Spirit Light? No, everyone's on 100% health. Do I want to cast this? No. She's not going to try and heal anyone, okay, at the start of a battle because everyone's going to be at 100%. So what's going to happen is she's going to run in, and just like all the Mesmers who are gung-ho wanting to do damage, she's going, we'll keep her on guard, I don't know whether that stops her doing her healy things, right? She's going to want to do damage, so when they all cast Energy Surge, she's going to cast her spell as well, which is this elite Icy Veins. So Icy Veins scales with Soul Reaping. We're taking Soul Reaping for absurd energy management. And, well, now Livia gets to do crazy damage with it as well. So target foe gets struck for 90 damage, gets hexed, and then if it dies, it explodes. Doing 110 cold, it's not armor ignoring, it's cold damage now, but doing a ton of damage to the outside. We can even swap that, by the way, for Spiteful Spirit, which is pretty huge too, especially for this comp where melee people get to do extra damage. This isn't even big, and this here, this last 100 damage, is enough to just top off all the insta-kills we weren't really getting before. So just to demonstrate to you guys, I want to show you... I guess we'll do Thunderhead Keep. Why not? Let's do Thunderhead Keep. Do you know another cool thing that we might do? No, let's do Thunderhead Keep, okay? So I'm just going to show you. We won't finish the whole thing. What we'll do is we'll go to the fort, and I'll show you how it works as we talk about some other stuff. And when we get to the fort, you have to stand around for 20 minutes to finish the mission, so there's no way I'm going to do that. I also said at one point I was going to do a VOD showing off how all of this looked on Wooden Potatoes 2, and then I never did in the end. So this will be kind of the VOD thing. And then we'll be straight back to Nightfall. So here you go, guys. You should see all the herders basically in... Oh, come on, really? You got the giant stomp? And what I'm hoping to find here is that Livia's no worse off at doing... So there you go, look, she's keeping up with him a little bit now on the damage. This is crazy how a healer even does damage. I'm just trying to min-max this one thing. I'm just like, do you know what? I never really did this in Guild Wars 1. Let's just go nuts with it. So there's a bunch of casters up there. As you saw there, she casts Icy Veins. They're all dead. They all explode. Before, there was a chance like one might survive or something like that. Look at the cooldown on the Icy Veins as well. Look at the cooldown on that thing. It's absurd. So there we go again. And, oh man, they should all blow up. They should all die. This is so unfair. It's still pretty ridiculous though. But anyway, welcome guys. Yeah, I will be honest with you all. We're starting a little bit late. It is because I've been very busy, but it's not because I couldn't find the time to squeeze in. It's that I 100% forgot, basically. I've been so swamped doing so many other things today. I forgot that I had a stream still on the books. I don't know, somewhere in my head, I guess I just sort of thought, oh, never mind, I'll leave it. So what we're doing over here is going to like one of those really rare, weird places in Guild Wars 1 that exists, but there's basically no reason to come to them. Come to it, sorry. And that counts for most of prophecies. So the mission itself, we're supposed to go north, and then we go up to the fort here. But there's a whole chunk to the map over here where there's no quests, because we're in a mission. You never have quests in missions. There's no quests here. There's no NPCs to speak to. Wow, look at that. The toolbox map's bugging out a little bit there. We've got a bunch of enemies over here. We're nuking down. There's no enemy. Wow, what am I talking about? There's no like bonus objective. There's nothing. There's no reason to come here. It's literally like, hey, the player might get lost going through Thunderhead Keep, so let's add this area. These guys are interesting because they'll do Spellbreaker, so unless we interrupt their Spellbreaker or kill them through AoE, we actually can take a while to kill Griffins. But we got a couple of Dwarven soldier friends with us here as well. I'm just watching Livia just spamming Icy Veins again and again and again. And of course, once she needs to start healing, she's doing it. I wonder how much worse she's going to do. She wasn't a protective thing. So, before I change this elite. So here, look, we've got some Doliak. I was actually really shocked to see one of these missions. There's actually a Doliak stampede that I'd completely forgotten about. That was pretty cool. Has there been any news or rumors of anything related to raids? There has been. There's been, like, leaking going on and stuff. Or whether they're real leaks or not, nobody really knows, right? Like, it was some guy posted on Reddit, like, 3 weeks, sorry, th- weeks, 3 months ago, saying that he knew everything that was happening in Expansion Pack 2, and he was saying, like, there were going to be mounts, and he was saying that we were going to Alona, and we were fighting, Krakatorik, and that Palawa Joko was going to be there, and then there was, like, another leak from a guy who used to do the raid testing. Apparently this qualifies him to have talked about a bunch of stuff, and he was saying what he guessed the elite specializations were. Of course, none of this is verifiable. And I almost pointed out in today's video that it's kind of stupid to talk about this stuff. Like, people are like, oh, they get it right. Yeah, but there's loads of posts that come up like that and they get it wrong. So here we have the signet anyway, by the way, to break through the Spellbreaker. That's what I was originally going to try and tell you guys. I love this little house here. It's so cool. So there was a post on Reddit today or yesterday where a guy was like, oh, hey, here is everything that that we've heard of from all the various leaks, blah, blah, blah. And he tried to do, like, a compilation. He was like, if this gets deleted, it's confirmed that it's real. Not that it's just rumor and gossip mill nonsense. But what did you ask me? You asked if there was anything related to raids. Well, in that big post, there was, oh, apparently the next raid is going to be a one-wing raid. Now, I've personally speculated that that could be the case before. And the reason I've speculated that is because they said they might like to do it. It seems like it would kind of work. If I were them, I'd look into a one-wing raid, honestly. But I don't know. That's it. That's as far as you can get for rumors and stuff on raids. And you can't really go any further than that. There was another leak recently, apparently, with a mace. Yeah, well, we knew that already, and this is what I'm talking about, right? Like, some of these leaks, supposedly, are, the big... But we already knew that they'd made a mace. We already knew. And then the mace was the most far along legendary weapon that they had. Then Mo swept in and said, look, this is, you can't be doing this, guys. A perfectly reasonable decision, in my opinion. And they finished Chukra and Champua. You know, the art for the mace may have been done or whatever. Whether this supposed leak's descriptions of it were real or not, well. Thank you. Enjoy the patch tomorrow. Yeah, I hope it's going to be a good one. I hope we'll all enjoy the patch. And this doesn't break horrendously. I mean, they managed to get Heart of Thorns out without stuff breaking horrendously. Look at this. Look at this. They're all in, like, no health. Like, they're just on the edge of death. There you go. And now they all die. Just on the edge. Do you know what I should run? Oh my god, do you know what I should run? Hold on, guys. Hold on. We're going to get this min-max rolling here. What we're going to do is we're going to take one of the mesmers. Okay, this guy here, Crystal Twister, who's currently running Ritualist purely for Flesh of My Flesh and a bit of Restoration. We're going to drop that down. And then what we're going to do is we're gonna drop Fast Casting. Less Fast Casting means less damage, so it always whizzes me out. But we're going to go Ranger. We're going to go Beast Mastery. We're going to bump the Beast Mastery up ever so slightly. We're going to add Edge of Extinction. Whenever a creature dies, all other creatures take damage. But it's only 19 damage right now. How much energy is it? 5 energy to cast, 60 second cooldown. Will they cast that smartly? AoE is like hilarious, by the way, in terms of 10 and 10. That seems good. There you go, 38 damage. Let's see how our nukes go now. Let's see if we can just... Yeah, but it's on a 60 second cooldown, so I don't think I like it. That's not the way to go. That's not the way to go. I'm a fool. I don't know. What else could we do? We just need that last little push. Something really quick. Some big spike. Maybe the answer is to put everyone on... bump everyone's fast casting up a bit more. They're all at 16 domination. I mean, I can't go too much crazier than that. Let's just drop a red stick on there for a second. Is there some kind of spike... AoE instant activation spike that I can put out there somehow? Have you already played the content so you can put out videos when the patch releases? No, I haven't. Not yet. Mistrust. Signet of Disruption. Well, my answer to that question is actually fairly complicated. But we'll just leave it at no, I haven't for now. Because it's not really something to talk about on the stream anyway. They'd cast Edge of Extinction on cooldown. Yeah, and then it might not be good with certain patrols and stuff. I don't know. Anyway, look, this is supposed to be a Nightfall stream. I just love this team build. And I've been having fun with it. I wanted to do a little bit there. Oh, somebody was trying to trade with us. Let's go back in there and see what he was trying to trade. Hello? Sorry, I didn't mean to leave you. Where are you, buddy? Where are you? There, Zephyr the Dervish. Hello. Somebody did point one thing out that would make us do way more damage. I tried to set them up with reasonable, like, staves and things, but it's not perfect by any stretch. You could set them up with main hands and off hands, and you could have 40-40s on all of them, and that would be absurd, as far as I remember. Oh, Gifts of the Traveler. Thanks very much, but, I think you should keep those. Thank you very much, but, I don't think I need them. Ritlock has no pants. That's awesome. If you're gonna give me stuff on... our Nightfall character, who we'll get to roll in with straight away here. And, because he's going to need it, right? Because we got such crazy builds. Where the hell is... Here he is. Wooden Spear Tato. Guild Wars Pro Strats. Oh, man. I got so into PvP recently. Like, super into PvP. Ah, it's weird. It's weird. All right, yeah, we got to ride in Refuge. Oh, exciting. Guys, is the sound all good, by the way, right now? Can you actually hear the world's... Can we, experience the Elon? Let's turn effect volumes down a little bit more. That I don't ever really like very much. Okay, there we go. Cool. All right, so what do we got here? We'll play with a bit of toolbox on now because I've now actually finally... Oh, no, I haven't done a video on it. Damn it. Well, we'll leave it on and I'll do the video sometimes later. But I've already been showing you a bit of toolbox. Wait, where's my toolbox UI? All right, whatever. We will just... drop that up there. There we go. And move our compass over there. God, I'd kill for this in Guild Wars 2. I'd kill for it. So good. There we go. Alright. Let's get that nice and hidden. Okay, so our story continues. Rylan Refuge, located high above the banks of the Ellen River. The refuge is used... by the nearby villagers and workers as a temporary camp. When the Ellen River overflows its banks every spring to give life back to the fertile plains, the residents of the surrounding area retreat here until the floods have subsided and the land is restored once more. So there's kind of this controlled flooding idea, obviously the very North African-inspired continent we're on right now, and I guess this comes from the real-world equivalent of the Nile, of which that was a very big thing. That's always one weird fact that I can always cite my source for. You know how you know a load of stuff, but you can't always source where you know all your stuff from? Because then you'd only have room for half as much stuff, because you know what you know, and you need to know where you know where you know from. But that, to me, I always remember I know stuff about the Nile, and I know stuff about Egypt, because when I was, like, in year 5 at school, I did, a topic book on Egypt. Anyway, so... The Master of Whispers, as you may recall, has actually led us here. We also finished the Signet of Capture quest, so let's go do that and cash that in way back at the Marga Coast. Now, you might think, oh, is that really worth the WP? You're only going to experience... Well, my point here is, actually, we still have two heroes that need experience. We've got Zed Shadowhoof and we've got the Master of Whispers. And we may as well use the quest XP to help them level now. If they get to level 20 on their own, then it's really not worthwhile finishing this quest in any respect, so... WP, loved the Fire Island tour vids. It was weird to see you there again, as you are now, compared to when you did your Let's Play there. Yeah, it was kind of a weird moment for me. Like, I was sort of holding a mirror up to myself in a lot of ways. And not just sort of seeing where, how far I'd come, but also seeing how little distance I'd come, right? It was like, my god, 6 years later, and what are you doing? You're doing basically the same videos that that you did way back when. It's just this time you're on super easy mode instead of on super extreme hard mode. So you can do it all in one video in about an hour of content instead of like 10 videos, which is what the original Fire Island series was. So I don't know. We've got this same dialogue again. The only reason we're being attacked is because of them. The Sun Spears have brought this upon us. Oh, or is this new? I think this is new. Zekanu says, yeah. We have two people here. Didn't we do these quests? They will kill us all within the hour. Should we defend these guys? Oh my god, topic books. Yeah, topic books are one of those things. If you did them at school, you need to keep that stuff, man. I can take those garrison fools with one hand tied behind my back. We don't need those weak, foreign. Hold your tongue, Chudo. We're not actually all foreign. We've got Koss with us, who's Cornan. We've got Milani with us, who's Cornan. We've got Master of Whispers with us, who presumably is Cornan. I guess Tal'Kor isn't Istani, but she's... foreign. While it is true our new friends have brought additional difficulties to Runjok, they are not to blame for our current situation. What are we gonna do? They'll return, and with tenfold more men. If we don't hit their quota, they'll take it out on our hides. Bayo will not give up until he conscripts every last one of us. Uh-oh. These soldiers are a superstitious lot. They have forgotten the darker ways of our peoples. What? That doesn't make any sense. If they think we're defenseless, they are wrong. Help me, heroes. Help me defend Runjok once more. Alright, cool. Let's do it. So, Chuno's just got the repeatable quest Insatiable Appetite. If you remember where we feed his Drake, which we got him, which we don't have to worry about. Menozi says, when I was young, blah, blah, blah. Which we talked to him before. This is the reward for the Signet of Capture. Well, you seem to have mastered the use of the Signet of Capture. Congratulations. As a reward, I will give you one more Signet, free of charge. So, we could learn it. We could get another Elite skill, but I guess not. Somebody did give me advice in Guild Wars 2 earlier while I was preparing some content, which you guys won't see just yet. But they sent me some messages with some advice about our build, which I will talk to you guys about soon when we have a bit of a vote to change up. And here's the new quest. My worst fears are realized. The Cornans have had enough and are marching on Runjok Village even as we speak. It is death they wish upon us, so it is death we shall give them. By the time we finish, those Cornan soldiers will prefer Varish's wrath to facing us again. As a young man, I was touched by the icy hand of Grenth himself, and I now can commune with the dead. It's an exhausting process, and I have hoped to have avoided using it, but it may be our only hope. I will need help. Will you offer this old man... will you help this old man and defend his home and his people one more time? This is the moment I need to get my glasses on, because I'm a terrible reader without them. So, what's kind of cool, actually, and completely coincidental, is he's like a monk that's healing. He's using a Horizon of Healing. He's using that to heal our minions, which are slowly building up because of Aura of the Lich. This is the new Master of Whispers stuff here, guys. Oh, dear. And look, you can see he's sacking his health down. He's losing a lot of health. What is it that he's got to sacrifice health here? Why is he losing health? I don't understand. Jagged Bones? Does that cost him health? Oh, it's because he's using Masochism. Lose 3% of your health whenever you cast a spell. And he's doing that on Jagged Bones. That's a bad idea, guys. Look, he's not even in a fight and he's doing this. That's a bad idea. I'm sorry. We're going to have to, like, either micro-masochism or disable it on him. I'm going to disable it for now. Because he's going to kill himself casting Death Nova and Jagged Bones. He doesn't even need to be doing that right now. Jeez Louise. That's crazy. But alright, so here we go. You take care of the spell, we'll do the rest. Why can't I hear the client? What's going on? Sound. It's not muting. We can put it to highest quality. Can you guys hear the game? Oh no, I can hear it. I can hear it. Alright, that's okay. Is it correct that I saw water moving up and down in Ember Bay behind the scenes video arena at Power a few days ago? I never actually looked too closely at that, so I don't know. Alright, so we got this quest. Undead defenders. Route the remaining quantum forces, and we have three groups to route. So here we go. They're coming in now.
By order of War Marshal Varish, Ronjok is to be destroyed for failure to meet its production quotas. This impertinence is a threat to Corner that must end. Its structures will be leveled. Its inhabitants will be resettled. Those who survive, that is. Those who resist will face my blade.
Well, let's face it, bro. Let's see what you got. We have an army of minions now because the Master of Whispers is with us.
What is this madness? Undead? Also, of course, because in the story we're summoning undead out of the bodies from the attack we missed earlier.
Yep, undead.
Charge! Charge, you fools! Charge!
Oh my god, look at the minimap. Look at the minimap. There's a lot of mobs around. Oh god. It's okay, we got a lot of Bane minions. Both from our Master of Whispers. As well as from the Elder. They're holding the southern entrance while we grab the western. And hopefully we can do that with some speed. We should swap our priority here. I don't want all of his minions to die too quickly. So let's move on over. Do we have aggressive refrain up still? We do. Okay, very nice. I don't remember how hard this is. This isn't master difficulty, is it? Was Nightfall when they introduced master difficulty? I think it was. And I think we already talked about it with the mime quest in Istan, so I won't bother. Don't you return here later in darker times? You do indeed. Because, of course, this is a very important place to people like Milani. So the game does play with this. This is one of those very fun... I love what happens in the later stages of this game, where you get to see all the... darker, shall we say, versions of these places. Oh, it's so good. Good job. Elder Jonah's minions actually messed them up there. Pure minion carnage, that was. There you go. So, that's that wave done. See Elder Jonah for your reward. Sup, Jonah? How's it going?
Ah, that scared him, but good. That trick won't work twice, but it will do the job.
They won't return to Ronjok for quite some time. But I fear for our land. Things are getting... darker, and not just for Ronjok. More and more young men and women are being conscripted. Other conscripts are mysteriously disappear. Varish's quotas have gone through the roof. We barely get enough water for the fields. I hope that you, my friend, will be the light that guides us through the impending darkness. Many wish you Sunspears had stayed in Istan, but many more who have no voice to speak believe you are our last hope. Please accept this as a small token of Ronjok's appreciation. And there you go, that leveled our friends up. So yeah, that's it for Ronjok. Cool little quests, cool stuff going on. Goodbye for now, Elder Jonah. And I really do mean just for now. Let's go back to Ryland Refuge. Let's spend those attribute points on Zed, who's now maxed himself out. So there's a bit of cheeky energy storage for him. We don't care about his secondary attribute just yet. And so yeah, we read about Ryland Refuge. We watched the cutscene at the end of the last stream. Nothing for it, guys, but let's head on in. Okay, if he's not going to use masochism, what should we put on him instead? I'll tell you what I think we should put on him. I think we should go Ritualist second, tiny bit of Restoration Magic, cheeky little flesh in my flesh. Done. Just give him a bit of res. Cool. Are you surprised? Oh, we already saw this. We are ready to kill this demon. We are not surprised to see you, Jin. Remember, because this is a Jin? Let's turn that off. I will take... Oh, Zelbe the Dervish. Hello. Are you going to help us out? If we take that to the Isle of the Nameless, will we get Balthazar's weaponry? Oh, gosh. What is this? Oh, dude. I can't accept that. Can I accept that? Actually, these have cut down in price a lot. It's not like the old days. Zelba the Dervish, if you're listening to the stream, seriously, dude, can you type a 1 in-game to absolutely confirm you want to throw this money down the toilet? So what this is, guys, is one of the main upgrades you get for your characters is a rune of vigor, and you've got minor, major, and superior, and they have no downsides to them like many of the other runes in the game. They just give you more health. So these this costs a couple of platinum each, and what he's done is he's given us, I can't believe, type a 2 if you're absolutely sure. I feel weird about taking this. Type a 2 if you understand this is a random character on a small stream that, well, you're probably never going to see it again, eventually. This would be really helpful, though. This is like each of our heroes could pick one of these up, and that's going to increase our... Dude, thank you so much. This is crazy. This is so helpful. Thank you very much. So basically, okay, so accepting... I would never accept something like this in Guild Wars 2. What are you doing? We've got enough. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah, that's 7 heroes. I'm going to cancel this, but if it's rune, it's runes again, I'm going to cancel this one. Yeah, thanks for that stuff, but don't worry about that stuff. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Okay. So basically what we can just do is, I already had Major Vigor, I guess I already bought one. And he's waving goodbye. What a cool guy. This helps us a lot. Oh, no, 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 not even the Strength Rune. So we can slot these in. Basically the idea is, as we keep playing, we're going to slowly but surely... Oh, no, not even Scythe Mastery. Slowly but surely, we'll put them all on gloves, shall we? We're going to keep upgrading our armor, and we've got to keep doing that to keep up. It's funny because in so many ways, Guild Wars 1 hid it from the fact that it still had progression, right? Like, so what, you got to level 20. The level 20 idea was really quite novel. It hid the fact that there was still a lot of progression there. You had to get insignias for all these things. You had to get runes for all of them. You could get away with not giving people appropriate weapons, to be honest, but, you know... all that stuff would help. Okay, so there you go, guys. Thank you so much, dude. Yeah, they were like 30. So the at one point it was like Major Rune of Vigor was like 3 platinum or something, and the superior one, which is only 9 health more, only 9 health, even in Guild Wars 1, which has lower numbers, that's still crap all, right? Like, I've only got 596 here anyway. 9 health. And it would cost like 30 platinum, just because it was the best. It was crazy. Alright, so Master Whispers is with us. He says, "We must move quickly. The power of the drought grows stronger with each passing moment. Deja knows how to access the Mankellan waterworks. I have convinced her to lead us inside. Once we meet with her, we will be off." So we go, we're at Rylan Refuge, and we're going to go deeper into the waterworks here. This is actually quite a hard mission, and I'm really happy we got those runes, because the final boss is a deadly bastard. So here's Deja, the djinn. "Come, Sunspears, I will show you the way. We must be careful. This area is well guarded. Cornins are everywhere, as well as the drought's minions." Do you think Guild Wars 2 needs progression? I think that Guild Wars 2 needs to handle its progression in fractals better, but the concept of having generally everything's quite easy to get to, and you can clear a lot of the stuff without going all the way through the progression, as we see in the raids and all that stuff, I think that's all excellent. I think that's true to what Guild Wars is about. I think that releasing expansions without pushing level cap is what Guild Wars 2 is all about. I like all of these ideas. But do you know what I think is better? Wow, if Deja dies, do we get game over? Deja, what the fuck is wrong with you? Did you see that shit? She runs in, makes us fight these drakes, and then just buggers off and tries to solo 5 other drakes, 4 other drakes over there, and gets herself killed instantly at the start of the mission. Jesus Christ. Deja, I just lost all respect for you and your djinny kind. You're pathetic. Pathetic. Alright, let's try that again, shall we? What were we talking about? Fractals, yeah. I like all of that. I like Guild Wars 2 in general has been a game that doesn't care about the progression too much. But I know that people like that sort of building your gear up and getting higher tiers of stuff and, you know, getting new slots to put more things in. And I think that Fractals is the perfect place to do that. I think you a good concept for Guild Wars is to have a small slice. Here you go, look at her, look at her, look at her. She makes you think you're going to fight those and then she doesn't. That's just trolling, basically, on the part of the devs. But the thing is, the Fractals don't do it well enough, in my opinion. So I like that. Fractals can be the small slice of Guild Wars 2 that has Oh my god, they're in a meteor shower. That's amazing. I'm seeing meteor showers lately and scared shitless by them because of Hydra. But obviously, we have the meteor shower now. Check out the wards. Yeah, look, Zed's wards and stuff. Oh, this is cool. And we got minions coming up. This is a weird little hybrid comp we've got going on here. So yeah, fractals is my answer. Put them in fractals as best you can. And then we'll talk. It's just all about improving that. By the way, it's Pirate Week in Guild Wars 1. Yeah, bottles of grog and stuff are dropping. Stuff's still dying pretty comfortably. I wonder if these guys are still stripping enchantments a lot. Oh, by the way, one thing I kind of told you guys. When we voted on Master of Whispers and what he can do and all that stuff last week, I was kind of trying to tip you guys off that we could make him like an Orders guy. And then we could combine it with Strength of Honor and stuff and super buff up Koss and Manoli. And us as well. I mean, we have 3 physical DPS and 2 magic DPS right now. Sort of. I mean, the Smiters are kind of magic DPS. Let's go for that guy as well. So yeah, the advice that I was given, what we'll do eventually, guys, is maybe when we get to Valby, we might do a bit of a fresh start thing. Now that we've got a full party, okay, we're finally capped out. I think we've got a full party. We're 8 out of 8, yeah. And so now that that's happening, basically, we will meet new faces, but they're going to swap around with our current people, and we'll have new people to vote on their builds and all that kind of stuff. That's all fine. Okay, so we just got to keep following Deja, who's going to go up against these drakes over here. What I think might be really fun is that when we hit a new region, we can start, as we go to new outposts and stuff, each time we hit a new outpost, we'll have a little vote to change an existing build, okay? And that's when we can start incorporating secondary professions and stuff like that. And we can watch the whole team constantly, like, formed by Twitch, ooze and mold and change what it is as we continue playing. And that gives you guys lots more opportunities to interact and stuff, right? So the second we're done with the corner chapter, which we're getting closer to the end of now, that's what I think we'll start doing, okay? So the first Vavian outpost we get to, we'll change my build. Then the next one, we'll change Koss's build. Then the next one, and the next one, and the next one, and the next one, and the next one, right? If you want stuff to be more accessible, you'll be done with the game so fast and quit. Look, it's really not a topic that you can sum up that quickly, though, is it, mate? You can't just say that. Because there are absolutely games out there that thrive on that don't even need formal progression in the way that MMOs offer it, you know, because their sandbox features are more satisfying. It's a huge, huge, huge thing. As you head to the reservoir, try to shut off as many water pumps as you can. This will reduce the flow of water. Oh, I remember. To the drought and weaken its power. The drought has placed an enchantment on the pumps. As long as droughtlings or cornins are near the pumps, you won't be able to turn them off. Good luck, Sunspears. Move forth and free the Elon from this plague. So there you go. This time she survived and she's opened the door for us. So this is a very rare mission for Guild Wars, in that the secondary objective for it, the bonus, if you've noticed for a lot of the other bonuses that we've done so far, they've been, like, it's been extra work for us, remember? So it's been like, okay, go kill all of the insect thingies in the swamp. Take out the additional commanders here or there. Do that, you know, extra stuff off on the sides. Usually that's what the devs do. You got to put in more work if you want the bigger reward of more experience and gold and so on and so on and so on. You want to be the completionist. This is a very rare example of a mission where you actually do less for the bonus. Because basically what's happening now is you've got all these little packets of droughtlings near this pump. See that? That pump control lever? You've got to kill the droughtlings, then hit the pump. And what this does is this starts flooding nice, clean water and gets the waterworks running again properly. Because this is the place that's responsible for keeping everywhere fertile and happy and nice. So, what's the idea? Well, the more of these that we grab, the weaker the final boss will be. And we get a morale boost each time, so plus 2% to maximum health and energy. So 4 or 5 remaining, and you can get as many as you like. And you might think, okay, so the bonus is to get them all. Actually, no, the bonus is to get none. The bonus is to kill the final boss when he is in his most powerful state. And the drought is a dangerous demon. strong elementalist, something you don't want to fuck with, generally. And he can wipe you at the end of the mission very, very easily if you're going for the bonus. So this is a funny thing where if you're good enough for the game, you've got a good enough comp, just power through, and it's actually much shorter for you because you don't have to get the pumps. All of this said, I don't have that much faith in our team comp. I apologize. If we were on my Mesmer way thing that we opened the stream with, absolutely I'd do this. My god, it would just destroy all this stuff. The final boss is a friggin' caster as well, so the drought probably wouldn't even get a single move. In fact, I would love to see what this mission's like on Mesmer Way. I think that would be amazing. So yeah. You just watched the YouTube episode about this quest? Really now? Awesome. You guys that are watching those old series, I know it feels like a really stupid idea and that it's never going to count for anything. Because you got to understand, I watch a lot of Let's Plays myself on YouTube. I wouldn't be on YouTube if I didn't enjoy what some people made on it and so forth. Whenever I'm watching like an old Let's Play that someone did years ago, I never, ever, ever, ever feel compelled to leave any kind of comments or anything. It's funny, I'm actually more of a lurker than anything else, right? Like, I don't leave many comments. And it's not just because there would be the Wooden Potatoes tag on it and I might get recognised and blah, blah, blah. It's just that I generally don't. But the thing is, when you're watching like an old series, like a five-year-old Let's Play. Not that there's a five-year-old playing the game, but that the Let's Play itself is 5 years old. It's like, oh, there's no one else in the comments right now. I can't affect the series. The content creator is never going to see this, so why would I ever leave a comment? I try to be a bit better than that. If you're watching my Nightfall stuff right now, I promise you, if you leave comments on any old video, I look at my comments, not just the newest videos, the old ones. And generally speaking, if you leave a comment on an old Let's Play, if you leave a comment on Azurik or some of the early Tomb Raiders, if you leave a comment on the old Uncharted stuff we played, on the Bioshock series we played, any of the original Guild Wars stuff, as long as there's some substance, something for me to talk about with what you've said, I'll respond to you. It's not useless. That's my point. I try to do what I wish other people would. So yeah, leave comments. I love reading comments on the old stuff. I really do. It's awesome. Mahio says I'm like that too. Dude, I think it's you that I see on a lot of other YouTuber comments, right? Or it might be Malik that I see. I don't know. Or Mahius. There's like three of you guys beginning with M, and you're all like really long-term watchers that I'm all super fond of. All three of you. You got Mahio, Mahius, and I'm pretty sure it's Malik. Is there anyone here that can invite me to the EU Guild? No, there's no such thing as an EU Guild. And I'm on Guild Wars 1 at the moment, unfortunately, because they never sync to the guilds and friends list and stuff across. Agent of Whispers says, stop, who goes there? And the Master of Whispers says, Agent of the Order, step aside and grant us passage. My apologies, Master. I didn't expect you to be traveling with sun spears. Quickly, pass through before the guards see you. So here we see the Order of Whispers. This is actually, I think, like the first time we have seen Subterfuge be a part of the Order of Whispers. The rest of it's been about demon hunting. I guess there were talks before about, everybody in Istan probably works for me, they just don't know it. That's sort of Subterfuge-y as well. But there we're properly seeing it. That is a spy. Stationed in enemy territory, pretending to be the enemy, and assisting us through the area. That's cool. Right, so we've got to be careful of aggro here. Why, thank you. I mainly just do your vid or Visual Wood videos. Dude, I see you all the time, and I've seen you've been watching for a long time. Names stand out to me. They do, eventually. Man, I really want to come back through on Mesway. What is wrong with me? Guys, I'm changing it up here. I'm just going to go get all my mercenaries. They'll all start at level 20. I'll just put all the builds on them. And we'll just cheese our way through the rest of Nightfall. Let's change it. No more Twitch voting. You guys, you're a joke. I'm sick of hitting zeros. Alright, okay. So I got some advice about what to run the Paragon on, right? And as I say, we'll have an opportunity to change my build coming up. So the advice was this, that What we could run is, like, we could go slash warrior. I believe, actually, early on, we'd voted for something like that, for being slash warrior. What do you say? Hey, what are you guys doing here? Please don't hurt me. Don't worry, we don't want to hurt you, dude. Unless you're a threat to us. We would go slash warrior and go, like, axe or something. So we'd be melee. And then what you do is you run a blazing finale, which is every time a shout or a chant ends on you, you do AoE 6 seconds burning, which is pretty good for normal gameplay. That's pretty good. And then you just spam go for the eyes while you're fighting. So go for the eyes makes your melee attacks crit. The shout expires. You put burning around you. It recharges a second later. Burning around you. Recharges. Burning around you. Recharges. Burning around you. Burning. And so you can just basically have perma burn on people you're fighting. And then you can run something like They're on Fire, which reduces the damage that burning people can do to you. He seemed to be a big fan of this build because he said he mained Paragon for years. It is something I've heard of before, for what it's worth. But maybe you guys like the idea. It's not going to be up to me in the end. It's going to be up to Twitch chat. There are many other ideas as well for Paragons. But yeah. And that won't be a vote for today, by the way. But WP is freaking amazing at responding to comments. I commented on Azuric a while back and I didn't expect a response. Prove me wrong, same as one of the episodes of War and Kryta. I think when you were retrospectively talking about Aurora Glade being one of the missions you were most worried about. Here's one of the things, right, like, that I find funny. It's really easy to judge big YouTubers as, oh, they don't give a shit anymore, they're in it for the money, they're just doing it because whatever, and they're lazy, they're whatever, because they don't respond to comments. I've kind of experienced myself, though. Comments have always been a big priority for me. A big priority for me on YouTube. Because I feel like it shows that you care. And if you genuinely do care, you have the time for the people that are making you what you are, right? It's beyond just common courtesy for me. It's fun, too. I enjoy comments. I do it all the time. But the thing is, as you grow, like, so I've had periods where I've been a bit bigger. And I've had periods where I've been a bit smaller. Specifically, like, when Guild Wars 2 released, I was much bigger. When Heart of Thorns released, and that was a good solid 6-7 months worth of being pretty big as well. The funny thing is, though, you end up getting so many comments that I was leaving just as many comments. I cared just as much. I spent just as much time doing the responses for people. But because now every single video is getting 400, 1,000, 2,000 responses from other people, your stuff gets swallowed up. So my point here is, don't be too judgmental to very big YouTubers. Because for them, it doesn't matter how many comments they leave. Even if a few of their comments that they leave get super upvoted and become more visible, that visibility only lasts for a period of 6-7 hours or so before it gets completely swallowed down again by just thousands of other comments. So it's funny that you can put in the same amount of it, you just look like you care more the less viewership you have. What really gets to me, what I judge people for, is when they don't have an audience, they're obviously not getting many comments, and they don't even talk to people. You know, you've got a handful of people who are supporting you. You've got this ridiculous idea to try and be someone on this platform, a community-oriented platform. It's all about interacting with people, okay? It's social media, basically. Have the fucking respect to talk to these early adopters, right? At least do that. At least indulge people when they ask you questions. Not even just when they ask you questions. It boggles my mind that anyone would be on YouTube and not have an audience yet, and not even, you know, you look at their comments, they got like 12 comments total on like a 3k video or something, like 3 to 10k, and they haven't responded to a single fucking one. Like, what are you planning? Like, it's on them, to be honest, if they do stuff like that. But I think it's a pretty shitty thing to do. It's their choice. Maybe they get different joy out of YouTube. Show me some fucking respect. Yeah, I'm swearing a lot today. I don't know. I'm in a swearing mood today. I guess we got some raffles going on, by the way. WP, do you think we're getting up a class? Jesus. I should have, like, a counter for every time someone asks me that. No. There is no space, no necessity for another class. All it does is bloat the workload for the elite specializations in subsequent years. There is no thematic nor gameplay mechanical concept you can give me that won't seamlessly fit into the 9 cart classes that already exist. Go ahead and try. Type something in chat that is a class or something that can't fit as an elite specialization. It will fit somewhere else. There's no need for it anymore. It's done, guys. So there you go. And here's another lever. So this, my friends, is the drought. Bit of a disappointment, I must be honest. It's a disappointment because he just looks like a stone crag, which we've sort of seen before. He's just a boss. There's one pump remaining, so he's not super. He's not entirely powered down. He has two droughtlings with him, who I think we're going to try and focus first. So let's knock out the droughtlings, shall we? Let's see what we got before they can cast stone flesh aura. I'm also going to try my best to spread out just a wee bit. And I'm going to do my part as well as far as the signets of synergy are going. So there's a meteor shower. Oof, Zed's taking massive damage. Come on, Zed, hang in there, buddy. And down we go. That is a pretty comfy mission right there.
What is that?
A friend of the drought, mourning its passage.
We're trapped in here.
Don't be too sure of that. Never walk into a room unless you're sure you can walk out.
Which means?
It means that there was a smuggler's hideout back here. An old Corsair friend told me about it. There. This should take us all the way north to Vabi. Let's move.
What is your problem, Hound?
The drought is dead. I can feel it in my bones.
The drought? Then there are sun spears in the waterworks. Go kill them. Kill them now.
All in good time, mortal.
We have them trapped. What are you waiting for?
You misunderstand, little mortal. You are not my master.
You are charged to help me hunt these sun spears. You will do as I say.
I answer to my Lord Abaddon. I answer to War Marshal Verish. I do not answer to you. Are we clear?
I am Verish's general. You should respect-
Verish does not need generals anymore. She needs us. Do not make her choose. We are partners at best, until all your sunspears are slain.
And then?
Then, we will renegotiate. I know where these sun spears are going. Follow me.
So, the curious reveal that the hunger can talk. Which is a bit of a funny one, I guess. I like the voice effect on him. You're going to see that they've done a very classic little move there. Nicely... comfortably sorted out. For this arc, they've introduced a nemesis to us. That's the hunger there. I love how the hunger refers to the drought there, like he's like their buddies, like they're the, you know, they're demons in arms, and that he's been defeated. And so yeah, kind of menacing. I also love that he's like shut up, Bale. You know, that they show even more tensions and things within the Cornans. So. We actually, if you're quite clever as well, if we'd done the other mission, if we'd actually chosen to free Cormyr and we'd gone back to Gandara and so forth and so forth and so forth, you actually would have been in a situation there. I'm going to sell the Istani key. Oh my god, we've got racing medals and stuff. I don't need these racing medals. Let's get rid of these. The Cornan coins we can keep. We can spend those. The grog we can drink. Oh my god. The Juniberries. Victory token, do I care about that? I don't think I do. I don't care about the Corsair trappings either. So we'll sell those. The Salient Sword we'll get rid of. Suntouched Spear we'll get rid of. Oh my god, Jesus Christ. Alright, so yeah, there was a lot I wanted to talk about. What was going on in chat there? When was the last time I did a full Domain of Anguish, Underworld, and Foe Run? It was definitely when I did it for the channel. I haven't been in there since I did it for the channel. So whenever those videos were uploaded, you can tell it would have been the week of those being uploaded. So I did Domain of I did Doa, Foe, and Underworld. I have not been in any of those since. Well, actually, Domain of Anguish I have been in, but it's to get footage to show off Ravenheart Gloom, stuff like that. It's not been for any deeper reason of actually clearing the content. Oh my god, are you serious? Dude, Magic So Malenko, are you the same guy as before? Are you happy to be doing this? Oh, he's got Guam. Congratulations, man. Are you happy to be doing this? This is awesome. This is like Guile's stuff, right?
Yo-ho, those wenches aren't saucy enough. Better drink me some more sauce.
Oh my god. Jesus, dudes. Take it, I do not need. Oh, this is awesome. Thank you so much. Do you know what I feel like right now? I feel like when I was on the Chinese client of Guild Wars 2 and we had like 1,000 viewers and everyone was hyped that their branch of the game was being shown and they were giving us all this stuff. Oh, I still... Oh, God, I feel really bad about that. They gave me like... they gave me like the pay-to-win thing and everything and I didn't even use it. Alright, well here we go. So we got a proper death magic staff now. That's like a full-on half death magic spells, half skill recharge of spells, death magic plus one, bit more health for him. Really wish this was the first MMO I played. I did things like FF11 and WoW instead. Guild Wars would have been a great deal more longevity for me. I don't know, honestly, whether that's true. Oh, he's dyed it green as well. Oh, look at that. You care enough about this staff to have dyed it, man. And now you're giving it to me? For a hero? On a random... It's like when you trade a Pokemon and it's got a nickname, right? Like, he's got his nice green staff here. I'm pretty sure he's dyed it anyway, because it doesn't match the icon. Maybe he hasn't dyed it. Okay. It was already green? Okay. Alright, maybe that doesn't matter. So yeah, alright, anyway, there were other questions as well. Reminds you of the mouth of Zaitan, I guess, yeah. Do some other streamers do and have a link to an unlisted YouTube video where you answer frequently asked questions? Yeah, but you lose the personal touch there. I'm happy to either ignore repeat questions or eventually exasperatedly say it and make people feel bad. I originally watched you for Guild Wars 2, but after watching your FFX LP, I found you to have some of the legit most information and best on YouTube. The hard work shows. Thank you very much. I cannot wait to get back to that kind of really detailed style of LP. Tomb Raider's been great, but there's only so much detail you can go into with that game. Most of getting the 100% and showing all the details is just like showing the locations of lots of artifacts and things. When we get onto the Elder Scrolls side of things, it's going to be pretty cool. Alright, let's... I guess that's it, right? I should really eat that Drake kebab to save up some more inventory space. So where are we, you might be wondering? Well, we're just behind the floodplain. Behind the waterworks, sorry. There's actually a quest here, super classic quest, that I don't think anyone who plays Nightfall can easily forget about. Here, look at this destroyer. Primordis is active. Woo! Maybe it's not available just yet. Or it's just up here. Let's have a quick look. Moving along. There's a corner noble up here. And a guy called Hagen. I guess it's not available, whatever it is. Look at that. That's very cool. I've never actually looked over there, I don't think. Goes out to the water. Oh, that's not right. That's the edge of the map there, and it shouldn't look like that at all. Okay, Hagen, what do you say? There's little time to talk, sir. We have to get through to Vabby, and those Cornans are hot on our heels. Is there anything I can help you with quickly? Tell me about past events. Cormyr has been freed from the Cornans' clutches, and the Marsh of Whispers has helped defeat a demon in the waterworks. Now, though, the Cornan army under General Bale is hot on our heels. Our only hope is to make it into Vabby before the entire Cornan army descends upon us. So yeah, Cormyr is free now, and she'll be reintroduced to us. How that happened, we don't know. What is going on? I feel so greedy and selfish, and it's amazing. I'm totally out of my comfort zone accepting stuff like this. It's an old game. We all know everybody's accounts are just full of items that are never getting used anymore, and they'll never really make use of. So that's why WP was playing with a mod for Oblivion. Oh, I've been modding the hell out of Oblivion. Okay, alright, so we've got some Divine Favor stuff. Thank you, I guess. So we've got a staff. which we can put on Donkey. Donkey Poo. The staff is Wenlaus's Faith. Energy, health, cheeky stuff there. And then Tal'Kora is actually going to have a main hand off hand set up. She's going to have a fire damage auto because of Divine Favor. That's interesting. Instead of holy damage. And that halves the casting and skill recharge for her. And then that her focus there is Divine Favor as well. Both of those guys do have 9 Divine Favor, I believe. Yeah, they do. Okay, excellent. So there you go. They both proc that stuff too. That's awesome. Okay, so current events. There's no time to stop and plan. It looks like there's only one way through to Vabi. We have to push our way through before the Cornan Guard catches up. You're halfway to Vabi. Don't give up now. Can you give me some tips? So this next mission is really cool. Donkoro gives good advice. Heed his warnings and you should get through without too much effort. Number 2, keep heading north. If you get lost, press U. Alright, blah, blah, blah. We don't need to care about that. Alright, so basically, guys, this is one of my favorite missions in Nightfall, and it's because of a classic RPG trope that I talk about every time it comes up, and it's the cave trope. It's the moment where you go into a deep, dark cave and you come out on the other side, right? For factions, that deep, dark cave was essentially Kaineng. And at the very end, they have you actually wade through a sewer to get out. For, you know, the Pokemon games, you usually have that cave that you end up having to go... most games, right? I like big RPGs, epic RPGs. You got the cave. And this is the moment for Nightfall. And it's excellent. It's really good. So, Modok Crevice. A smuggler's camp hidden behind the waterworks of Mankellen. The crevice is for those who don't want to be found, those who aren't looking, and those who just want to be left alone. Residents keep to themselves and strongly suggest that you do the same. Anyway, there's a quest here that allows you to get the banana scythe, which is a uniquely statted banana you can attack people with. Yep, no word of a lie. So this mission requires we have Donkoro in the party. That may have been a bit of a problem many years ago when you could only have 3 heroes. When we can have this many, it's totally fine. What a lucky coincidence. We've run into each other once again. Ah, unlucky Simon, hi. I see someone told you about the smuggler's route through Vabi. I'm pretty sure that old man Donkoro would be interested in this passage as well. When you and Donkoro are ready to head out, I'll clear the way. WP, don't you have the Eye of the North bonus weapons? I do indeed, and we're using them. Like, Koss. If you're talking about the Hourglass Staff thing, though, no, I never had that pre-order bonus thing in above. Oh, the banana scythe is if you go back to Ryland Refuge. So here we go, guys. One cool thing, by the way, I would love to mention, is the exit to Modok Crevice here, that gate... this is one of those weird maps, okay, where... Here, I'll show you how it really works. Sorry about all the delays and stuff. Come on, the trivia's cool, though. What do we have to do? How do we get out of this map? I don't like what I did with the UI there. Interface. Let's move it back up. Mission goals. I did that a while ago when I was messing around. So, it's basically telling us, look, a way to Vabi is open. Speak with Unlucky Simon to continue. I think it will tell us that every time we meet a new place. Kind of a little thing they never did too much of in Guild Wars 1. But this is one of those weird outposts where you can use a very cool glitch called the recall glitch. Or you can use Heart of Shadow. You can use a lot of different stuff. What you can do is when we walk to this portal, we're going to hit a loading screen, right? And it's going to teleport us into... the outpost, which is technically a totally different instance. However, if you bug your heroes back there, there's a way to do it with, like, ranger bear pets. I saw a video of a guy doing where you just keep running them in and the pets move further and further back or something, some skill that you can keep spamming. If you get the pets all the way back there and then you teleport to them or you use recall or whatever, you can teleport past the TP zone. This works in Guild Wars 2 as well, by the way. And by teleporting past the TP zone, which is where these guys are disappearing, right? You can actually walk down there into the outpost, even though you're not technically in the outpost, you're still in the floodplain of Mankellen. And if you do that, okay, I can't show you the glitch, right? But let's pretend we're still in the floodplain of Mankellen right now. If you come all the way over to this gate over here, this entrance, okay, with the gatekeeper, you can just physically walk through the gate, and you'll actually find that a lot of the cave there... is actually genuinely in the floodplain of Mankellen map, and you can wander around in it. It's cool. There's an interesting place you could do that in the Jade Sea as well. But yeah, alright, let's do the Pale Joke versus Emperor Kisu. Kantha versus Alona. Who wins? Sorry, do you mean Palawa Joko? Is Pale Joke one of his, like, nicknames? Joko versus Kisu. The xenophobic might of a united Kantha versus Palawa Joko's undead and Mordant Crescent, or whatever they are. I don't know, man. That's tricky. I'd probably give it to the Kanthans. There's a lot of water between them, though. I don't think we'd ever see it. All right, so here's the Corsairs who are going to help us go through. The Corsairs have been good to us. Magrid's not around, though. Hey, man. We should waste no more time. These caverns can be treacherous. They do look kind of scary. This isn't going to be like when the Fellowship goes into Moria, is it?
Ahoy, friends. You must be Wooden Spear Tato, and I recognize Dunkuroi by his description as well. We've been expecting you to come this way. We have a friend in common who asked us to escort you through these caverns to Varby.
Okay, hello. It's nice to meet you. To meet you nice.
Why do I think you're lying to us? Is it that you failed to name our so-called friend? Or is it perhaps just the way you clutch that blade? Either way, don't trust this one, Wooden Spear Tato.
So Dunkora gives us a bit of advice here. And what we're going to do... Okay, hold on.
It matters little to me whether you trust me or not. I've already been paid. But if you want to get through these caverns alive, you'll need a guard. Someone who knows the route that leads to safety, instead of the dozens that lead to death. It's your choice, Wooden Spear Tato.
So, remember that tips guy outside? He said, hey, I'd listen to Dunkoro. He's a pretty smart dude. That is the bonus here. The more you listen to Dunkoro, the better. It's a great idea for a bonus, but in reality, the implementation of it was really finicky and weird, and it was easy to actually fail the bonus, and you wouldn't even realize you'd failed it till the end. This is one of those missions you do again and again and again because you got cheated out of the bonus for some stupid reason. We're going to try and go for it, though, because we should, if we're following the story properly, care about Dunkoro, no? And what Dunkoro has to say to us. So, I cannot name my benefactor, only that he is very interested in seeing you reach Valby alive. I want to keep him happy, and what do you want to live through this trip? So what do you say, can we trust one another? And classically, when you click this, it just closes the window so you can open it again. So players at this point have been conditioned not to click this. But if they've been reading the dialogue, they probably will click, Dunkoro is right, I don't trust you. And they get mad at us and attack us. And, well, they kind of prove our point, don't they? They weren't to be trusted. My God, they got nuked. Fucking hell. Kisu would kiss Pale Joke and then marry, creating undead living hybrid son named Affliction. Jesus. You'd think that's got, like, a more of a regular RPG name, right? Like, an undead bred with a human. The offspring. Is that a thing? You'd think that that's, like, a ghoul, right? Or a phantom, or whatever. Kind of like, you know, how in sci-fi we all just understand what an android is or what a cyborg is or whatever, you know, these blends. That seems like that should just be a really normal thing. Who did I enchant before? Milani doesn't have it, so let's do that. Alright, so anyway, we're going through. We're on our own. Those Corsairs were no good. Lucky Simon was a bit of a douchebag. Indirect Kisu. The reason I said the Kisu there, I guess I never elaborated. It's because I view Kantha as a bit more technically advanced. You know, if we're taking like the Asian themes and stuff, as it was based in real life, these people have technology or had technology at a time where no one else had any. And maybe they never rivaled the dwarves or the Asura in terms of magitech. Here's how I'd describe it, guys. In Guild Wars 2, you've got various tech levels, obviously. I'm trying to just clear the way here. I want Dunkoro's advice. Did he give us a second bit of advice? No, not yet. You have various tech levels, obviously. So you've got the Asura, but they're magitech, all right? Their flavor of tech is magitech. You've got the Char, and they're very steampunky, right? And those are the kind of the two big archetypes there, really, that you're seeing in Guild Wars 2. So then where does the Kanthan technology fit in? Well, what I would actually say is, you know, steampunk is a kind of level of tech and idea that itself is very fantastical, as is magitech. I would say that Cantha, if I were the writers anyway, this would be the direction I would go in. I think the way we get to trigger Dunkoro's next advice is by coming and killing this group over here. So let's try it this way. It's like real world. Like, they just follow the real world level of stuff. You know, that they go through the same natural progression that planet Earth did. So what we see is that they're in kind of an 1800s, 19th century sort of period by the time we get back to them. Which can have steampunky elements or whatever in it as well. But that's what I'd see. I'd expect to see, like, Canthan railways and stuff, where we don't see Char railways. I mean, we see Char tanks. It's kind of weird. They haven't established the lanes very well. Maybe they don't have to. But that's what I'd see. You know, because, like, in Guild Wars 1, we had the Canthans had their fireworks and stuff. Just as we saw Chinese had fireworks super early in the real-world timelines. Anyway, alright, so we've cleared those. Let's go past the Balthazar statue over here. But yeah, not to say that there's no magic in Cantha. In fact, the way that the magic was fleshed out there is really interesting and awesome, in my opinion. But you know, they've got like a culture of assassins and stuff. So there you go, we got a prompt saying, yeah, you followed one of his suggestions. So here's his next suggestion. He says, wait a second. Notice how the path here is worn? See those footprints in the mud over there? It looks like a patrol comes through here on a fairly regular basis. Perhaps we should conceal ourselves. I spot a waterfall to the west that should drown out any noise we make nicely. So we're going to run over to the waterfall as fast as possible. Now here's how the bonus can fail. You see over there all of the bone minions aggroed because we were too slow on the patrol that we're supposed to be walking past? Well, that could spell disaster. That might have failed the bonus for us. I don't really care because I don't need the bonus. I don't know whether it triggers based on them getting in combat or whether it triggers based on them... And you see how this Jagged Horror now is running back to us. What that Jagged Horror is going to do, if we're not very careful, is it's going to aggro the entire patrol over to us also. So I'm going to run even further away than the waterfall now to make sure that doesn't happen. So the AI leashes. So there you go, the patrol's walking. We did lose all of our minions as well though. But yeah, they've got the combined might of the Kurziks and the Luxans, who themselves were masters of engineering in their own right, building giant cities half a mile into the sky on the peaks of these massive trees. That shit's epic, man. And then walking around on siege turtles and having such cannon fire and stuff that the Luxans had. Also very cool. So here's another scary thing. The patrol has dropped a spirit, and this is just cruel, really. Our friends would go in and attack that spirit, which would cause the patrol to turn around and charge us, which also could fail the bonus. So lots of fiddly little things. This is the fiddliest one. But there you go. We listened to Dunkoro's suggestion. We stood around. Hopefully we're okay. And, you know, but they had, like, very organized governments and ministries and... And they were no strangers to war either. The Kurziks were no stranger to war. The Luxans were no stranger to war. The people of Kaineng and of Xingji were no strangers to war with the Tengu. And the Xenophobe kicking people out such as they did doesn't come without bloodshed. Corsair camps, he says, there to the west. Our best plan is to stay close to the eastern wall here and head north around the camps. If we're careful, we should be able to avoid them. Proceed cautiously. Actually, that's not the hardest thing. I just remember what the hardest thing is. So we're gonna head around them by fighting these insects instead of going over there. Look at this. It's very cool, isn't it? This environment. We try to worm our way through. We try to worm our way around the camps. I think we go through here. And here's the hardest bit. So we've got to be ready with this one. I don't have full back, which would have been really nice. But let's see. You see how strung out our party is now with the green dots following behind us really slowly. So here, look, Dunkoro's gonna have more advice for us. He's gonna say something about these runners who I'm just gonna charge in before my adrenaline disappears. Shit. Oh no, I did get it. Go kill, 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 kill. That's one down. There's the other one all the way over there. We gotta go up. Shit. I think we've missed it. How are we supposed to do this? You're supposed to like hex him or something. Oh my god. Guys. Help me out. Oh, I think we missed it. Okay, so the last suggestion is you've got to kill both of those runners before they go warn their camps. And we let one of them get away, sadly, there. It's very easy if you have other builds, if you run hexes that slow them down, if you have cripples. If I remembered it, I probably would have put on a crippling spear attack or something. But yeah, the runners basically charge off to warn their camps. This one's quite buggy in a good way, in that I think sometimes you can atrociously fail this and you'll still be okay anyway. There you go. So there it says you followed 3 or 4 suggestions after we killed the two of them. Which is a shame. That should have said 4 or 4 and we would have been good. We would have been done, but we weren't. So I guess we'll just move past this and around and that should take us to where we want to be. You never played it in its height, but I enjoyed it as a single player or co-op game. What, Guild Wars 1? Is that what we're talking about? Yeah, apparently random arenas are active and people just get really salty if you don't run meta builds. Which I find funny. You'd think that the people playing these days are very much enthusiastic about the core of the game and not so desperate to have only one meta. Here we go, guys. This is the end of the chapter. Can we make it to Vabby?
Which way? This is a maze of twisty passages.
That way. I feel a fresh breeze. If you insist on going forward, that is.
What's wrong?
We should be organizing a rebellion in Korna. Instead, we're running.
We're not running. We're going to Vabby for help.
We're running. And this would be the perfect place for an ambush.
You are correct there, Sunspear.
Who's that?
You are the last of your breed, traitor. I will bathe in the blood of you and your comrades.
You don't have enough troops to beat us, General. Let us pass.
He does not fight alone. I will feed on your bodies and feast on your souls.
See? So there's you've got the recurring theme, never fighting alone appearing there. Look how well they structured that. You've got a big threat is established in chapter 1. You go, they naturally roll in this new villain, the Hunger, that you slowly learn more about as the chapter commences. And finally, the chapter concludes with an epic battle against the guy. It's cool stuff, right? And Bale. So Bale, we've been watching for ages. Bale's been at Varys' side for Christ knows how long with Kaiet, right? So job number 1 is to kill these bowmen up here. You have no honor, Sunspear, blah, 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 blah. I love that line as well. That's one of the very rare, well-voice-acted lines, in my opinion, in Guild Wars 1 from the player character, who said, who's that? And then the, you don't have enough to beat us. So here, I can't do anything. I'm out of range, really. But you'll notice that Susuke is more than capable of nuking these rangers. There's actually an interesting dynamic going on here, because elementalists actually don't do so well against rangers, because rangers have elemental resistances. But nonetheless, he's one of our more useful ways of doing damage here. Now that we've got minions up there as well, the Master of Whispers is summoning minions up there, which are now exploding in their faces and so on, which is also very, very cool. And I'm sure the smiters are able to get something there also. But you'll notice we've got Bale. Bale is actually interacting a little. He's using he's casting stuff on the minions, as far as I understand. So that's him dead. This is all our team here. This is kind of cool, right? It's like our babies are doing well. Look at this. Loads of minions. And they're going to run down in a second. Bale's still moving in. This is good. Really, you want to pull Bale away from the Hunger in this fight. As far as I remember, anyway. And so here he is. Here's the big guy himself. And let's see what happens. Kos goes running in. Kos the boss. Let's make sure he's enchanted with Strength of Honor, shall we? There you go, Kos. You have that. And they're getting nuked down. Excellent. So that's the death of Bale right there. Peace out, brother. And so Hunger's Bite. Attack. Seal health. And more if they've got lots of condies. And the target gets condied when it happens. But obviously we're cleansing. He's moving. He moved out of the meteor shower, which is pretty cool. Guild Wars 2 NPCs are still only just learning such a maneuver. He's hammered into the wall there. And we make sure we finish him off. This is a big moment. I always like this moment. And voila. We're through.
Good work, everyone.
It was probably an easier way.
I think you're right, Don Coro. The secret passage was hardly a secret. I intend to press on to Vabi. Anyone who wishes can go back to the sanctuary.
Of course I'm coming along. You'd be lost without me.
You have led well so far. I will follow.
You drag me this far, then ask if I want to be here? Typical Tulek thinking. Of course I'm with you.
This is my homeland. There's a celebration coming up. We can meet all the princes there.
Don Coro, will you be joining us?
Yes. Of course I will come with you.
With Korna behind us, we should be much easier.
War Marshal Varish, I have news of General Bale.
General Bale has been slain, and the Hunger as well.
I only got the reports just now. How did you know?
Thanks to my Lord Abaddon, I have a certain affinity to things. Call it a blessing.
We have to decide our response.
I have already made that decision. I've informed the princes that we will be pursuing Bale's murderers into their territories with all our available forces.
And they agreed to this?
They don't need to agree. We will be bringing our forces north in any event.
With all due respect, Varish, our military is stretched thin fighting rebel villages, centaurs, and corsairs.
Ah, Morgan, my old friend. Manpower is no longer a problem. I have made other arrangements.
Lyssa's blood. What are these creatures?
These creatures are our new allies. Did you not say your forces are badly stretched? With our new friends here, we can press on into Vabi.
The Sunspears are in Vabi now. They may rally the princes.
It matters little. These Sun Spears are only an excuse for us to do what we were going to do anyway. By the time they understand what is truly going on, old friend, it will be too late.
And so there we go. So you'll notice we killed Kayet, we killed Bale. The only general left at Varish's side is Morgan. All the rest of them have died now. Pursued by Varish's forces, the Sunspears flee north. I like that as well, that he ended up disagreeing with what had been decided so long ago to seek allies among the princes of Vabi. Don Corey's got a good point. We could have incited a response within Korna, but we're running from Korna. And now we're in Vabi. So we're going to be pursued by not just Kornans now, but these new mysterious creatures. And I guess we don't need to hold it over anyone's head or make it into a big deal. Those are Marganites, guys. Welcome to Vabi. It's not going to look too different just yet. I'll point out, by the way, that scene a second ago was at the Fortress of Jahai, which is the main entrance into Vabi, which they had blocked, remember? And we'll see the other side of the Fortress of Jahai very soon. But we head north into Vabi to rally the princes. And that's where I'm going to leave it for today, guys. I know that we've only been going about an hour and a half. But again, very busy day. So thanks very much for coming all. Thanks for the lovely compliments, the nice chat about Guild Wars 1 and all that good stuff. Next time, since we're in our first Vabi location, we will get to vote on a difference on our main build. So that should be pretty interesting. Hope you guys all have a great evening, and I will see you next week. Have a good one, guys. Well, many thanks again as well to the wonderful donations of weapons and runes and things. That was so awesome.